Hi, everybody, and welcome to a very special Q&A with Josh Levine, who is joining me live from London. How are you today, Josh?
Hi, Tom. I'm very, very well, thank you. Very nice to be here.
Yeah, good. And we are being joined.
Yeah, I'm in my shed at home, but yes, I'm here as well.
It's a great shed. And obviously today, Josh is going to be talking to us about Dunkirk, the Battle of Dunkirk, which you can see on screen now. And during the Q&A today, you can yourself post a question. If you are watching through YouTube, then you can use the comments function on YouTube to post a question. So if you are a teacher right now watching this in your classroom with your students, then you can log into YouTube and you can post their questions in the comments box, and then I will post those questions onto the screen. Also in the comments box, if you want to write a comment and just tell us where you are watching this from, where you are, and which class you're watching it with, then also great. I will also post that on the screen. I know we're joined by a lot of different schools around the UK today for this presentation. Hopefully you can hear and see me okay. Also let me know in the comments if you can or can't. Hopefully you can. Josh is a historian who has written multiple books about a lot of things, actually, but notably around Dunkirk, Forgotten Voices, and also the second book as well on Dunkirk. Josh, what was the second one called? Remind me.
It was cool. It had a very long title, the history behind the major motion picture, I think. So that was, it was kind of a tie-in with the film, explaining the history to people who didn't know.
Cool. And also, Josh has not only written two books on Dunkirk, but he has also advised on the movie Dunkirk as the chief historical advisor for Christopher Nolan on the movie Dunkirk, which we'll be talking about a little bit later, I hope. In addition to that, I know you've also written books on the Blitz and the Troubles in Ireland. And you are currently writing, am I allowed to say you're currently writing
a book? Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
And also Josh is currently writing a book on the North African campaign of World War II. So if you're watching it, and hi to Canon Slade, there are 75 students currently listening in Canon Slade School. So hello and good morning to everybody in Bolton who is listening along. And also good morning to everybody in Blackburn who is listening along as well. So thanks for those two comments. So we've got a couple of schools already saying hi. And if you are listening in, then do drop us a line. So in a second, I'm going to hand over to Josh. Josh is going to present a few things around Dunkirk. Some stories, some information. And while Josh is presenting, I'm going to be butting in with some questions. And also, if you have a question, then you can post it in the YouTube comments, and then I will throw the questions up on screen. So, Josh, I don't know whether that's a good enough introduction from me for you. But I'm going to pass over to you now and to kick off on a little introduction to what you're talking about.
Thanks, Tom. And thank you. Welcome, everybody. Thank you very much for coming along. Just to say, I've put together a little talk here about Dunkirk, about the history of it, and to some degree my work on the film. But this is kind of a free form thing, in that I don't want to make it too rigid. So, you know, Tom's going to interrupt me at points. It's going to be fairly casual. And hopefully, and if I can't answer a question, which is perfectly possible, then I'll say I can't answer the question. And but hopefully we'll all, you know, learn something.
Before you start, Josh, before you go any further, I've got this book here physically, Dunkirk, The Forgotten Voices, by you, the physical copy. The best question during this morning, I'm going to send this book to you in the post. So anyone who's watching, we've got another school in Southampton who's just said hi. Anybody who's watching, if you, teacher, if you're at the laptop, if you write the question and if you just put the name of the student who's asking the question, the best question is going to get a book sent out to them by me, Dunkirk, Forgotten Voices. Sorry to interrupt, Josh. Going to let you crack on.
Southampton. I was at Southampton University. No, I was at Southampton University 200-300 years ago. And so welcome, Southampton. I lived in Highfield for a couple of years and Portswood. So, and actually, I spent some time when I was writing a book on the Blitz. I spent some time in Southampton. Southampton was very heavily blitzed. And I got some incredible stories of that period out of Southampton. People used to go trekking in Southampton. They used to basically leave the city during the day and go and sleep outside the city at night and then come back and do their work the next day, which shows how tough people were back then. Anyway, that's another story. So I'll start with... start with this. This is the trailer for the film, and some of you may remember this.
The enemy tanks have stopped. Why? Why waste precious tanks when they can pick us off from the air like fish in a barrel? There are 400,000 men on this beach.
Dunkirk. There's no hiding from this, son. We have a job to do.
If we go, they will die.
See it from here.
What?
Home.
Okay, so that was the fiction. Now, this was the real speech that Winston Churchill, who was the Prime Minister at this time, gave when the troops were home.
We shall fight on the seas and oceans. We shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air. We shall defend our island, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender. And if, which I do not for a moment believe, this island or a large part of it were subjugated and starving, then our empire beyond the seas, armed and guarded by the British fleet, would carry on the struggle until, in God's good time, the new world, with all its power and might, steps forth to the rescue and the liberation of the old.
So that's, he's speaking there in early June of 1940, and it's a really interesting speech if you actually pay attention to it, because he's talking about we'll fight them, being the Germans, on beaches, landing grounds, in fields, in streets. He's talking about guerrilla warfare. He's talking about the fact that the Germans are coming and we will be forced to fight them in our home. So first of all, that's quite shocking if you think about it. He's telling the British people quite openly that we have big problems coming. And it's also interesting because he's speaking to so many different people at once in that speech. So he's trying to rally his own people for the fight that is probably to come for invasion from the Germans. He's warning the Germans that they're going to have a hard time. He's trying to reassure the French because he's trying to keep the French just about still in the war at this point. And also all that stuff about the new world with its power and might coming to our liberation. He's calling out to America because America hasn't joined the war at this point. And he's saying, my God, we need you, America. We need you so badly. Where are you? And we need you sooner rather than later, because if you wait too long, it's going to be too late. And this kind of ties in with why I think the whole Dunkirk story is important and in the past has been neglected, because there's a tendency to view Dunkirk across the world, particularly in America, as a kind of parochial little British story, nice little British thing that happened before America got involved in the war. And that's not true, because if the British army, the British expeditionary force had been destroyed or captured at Dunkirk, then Britain would almost certainly have had to try to make peace with Hitler. And Britain would then have become, as Churchill said in cabinet, in government, would have become a slave state. And we would be living in a completely different world today. It's hard to imagine. Europe basically would have been completely turned Nazi. And without Britain to hold on at that point, Britain and what was left, Britain's dominions and empire, without Britain to preserve freedom, I suppose, and the rule of law, then all the sort of the monstrous totalitarian norms of Germany, the world of brutality and slavery and totalitarianism would have bled right across Europe. There'd have been no free speech. We'd have been in a world of concentration camps, a world of, you know, total sort of brutality and intolerance. And, you know, we who knows where we would be today, but it wouldn't be a good place for any of us. And a lot of us wouldn't be here in the first place. So it's this sense of forgotten importance. That's why I was very glad to have been brought on board with Dunkirk. We've seen him. This is a picture of, you can see I'm there, and there's a man there called Christopher Nolan is sitting there, and there's a man called Arthur Taylor, who is a veteran of Dunkirk. I mean, dead now, but he was alive about 3 years ago. And the way I got involved with this, I got a telephone call pretty much out of the blue from the producer of Dunkirk, who is Christopher Nolan's wife, asking me if I wanted to be part of the film. And I at that point, I didn't really know who Christopher Nolan was. I like films, but I wouldn't call myself a film buff.
But if you're watching this somewhere and you're wondering who Christopher Nolan is, Christopher Nolan is the movie director responsible for Batman and Batman Begins, Batman, all the latest Batman ones is Christopher Nolan, along with a load of other things. I mean, he's done loads of movies, right?
Yeah.
So this is when you got the phone call from him, right?
And his films tend to be quite science fiction and quite sort of, and so this was I got a phone call from him, or from his wife, from the producer, asking me to come on board. And so he ended up coming to my house. It's funny, he's very, very famous in some ways and completely not famous in others. So he can go around London, walk around London, no one recognizes him. But at the same time, he's considered, you know, one of the great filmmakers of all time. So he came to my house and we talked and he ate a lot of biscuits of mine. And we chatted through his idea of the event and his idea of the film. He gave me a copy of the script. I didn't realize he's very, very secretive about his films. When Tom Hardy had the copy of the script, apparently Christopher Nolan stood over him while he read it, but I was able to keep it for a night. So I went through it and I really liked it. And what I really particularly liked those who've seen it. There were three distinct strands to it. All of this action took place on land, at sea, and in the air. And they were different stories, and they all interweaved, and they interlocked, and they sort of came in, they came out, and they interacted. But what it got across was there wasn't one single story at Dunkirk. There were lots and lots and lots of individual stories. And so people experience things differently. And that's very important for this film, but it's also important for history in general, for life in general. There never is one story. There are always different ways of looking at things, different ways of acknowledging things, different viewpoints, different perspectives, always. So, for example, at Dunkirk, there was good and bad behavior. There was good order. There was chaos. Little examples I can give. There was a man on the evacuation. People were moving in to Dunkirk. Soldiers were moving in. You had one man who was so hungry. He'd been on the retreat. He hadn't eaten anything. And he was found trying to eat the leather strap from his helmet. That's how hungry he was. So that's in one place at one time. Yet in another place at another time, there were some men, Royal Engineers, who found a cafe open behind the beaches, went in. So this was while the evacuation was taking place. They found a cafe. They went in. They ordered champagne. And they tried champagne. These were ordinary people, ordinary English soldiers, never had champagne before. Why would they? And they tried this. And one man said, I never tried, never had anything like it before. It was just fantastic. This is going to change my life. I didn't even know this kind of thing was available. And so, you know, in a very short space of time, in a very short geographical space of time, you had these incredibly different experiences. And we should always remember that, that there is very rarely one story. There were, for example, there were women there on the retreat and coming home. We'll hear about Augusta Hervey. Not many, but there were some. There were pets people were bringing. People were on the retreat. They were bringing animals with them, dogs that they picked up. One man had a bird cage on his head and he was standing in the water. There was a man who brought a motorbike with him. Up the mole was the big pier. We'll come to that. But a man was wheeling a motorbike with him, trying to bring it home on the boats, and they tried to, the Navy said, you can't bring that on board. He said, it's only done 2,000 miles, as though they were going to say, oh, okay, then bring the motorbike on board. People were bringing duty-free cigarettes. You know, they were, people hadn't been abroad before. These were young people who had never been abroad, wouldn't have any opportunity to be abroad. They'd been in France, and they were bringing things home with them. They were bringing souvenirs. People were bringing sand off the beach. People were bringing cigarettes. People were bringing things that they'd bought, presents for their family. So in the midst of this incredible, horrible, dangerous event, people were still, some people were acting like tourists.
We've got a few questions, Josh. I'm going to fire one at you. This is from 8L at Coombshead Academy. They want to know which story from Dunkirk had the biggest impact on you through your research for the film.
I think the air story, and I mean, they all did, but the air story, because, and we'll come on, I'll talk about this in a bit more detail later on, but I think because it kind of was the unknown story. Everybody remembers the Battle of Britain as being the great event for the Royal Air Force, and that was only a matter of weeks later. But actually, the Air Force was at Dunkirk, but what was interesting is that the soldiers and the sailors generally didn't see the RAF there for reasons I'll come on to. And they hated the RAF. They felt they weren't being protected from the German planes. And so RAF people who were shot down, who happened to be on the ground, weren't allowed onto the ships because the soldiers and the sailors were so angry with them. But they were actually there. So in a way, this was sort of righting a wrong to show that the RAF really were there. So I think that, in a way, is the most, for me, the most poignant. So the point I was trying to get across there was that you're talking about a large area, you know, miles and miles of beaches, 10 miles, over 10 days involving hundreds of thousands of men. physical state, some of them wrecked physically, wrecked mentally, some of them not so bad. And the stories that they present are completely different. The whole world was there on those beaches. It wasn't one story. And the film, I think, depicted that very well. And that's the thing to get across, that there wasn't one story, and there never is. Whenever you're dealing with any period of history, always be curious, always look for other stories. And when, you know, when I was talking to veterans, like I am in that picture there, they will tell you their side of things. They will tell you what they saw in their corner of that foreign field. But that doesn't mean it's the only story. And it doesn't mean that when veterans get together, they won't say to each other, well, that's not true. That didn't happen. What they really mean is, I didn't see that. I experienced something different. So you've got to know the fact that things were different.
That leads me on nicely, Josh, to this question here from 7S.
Yeah.
We want to know, do you think the soldiers at Dunkirk really understood that they were part of a miracle evacuation? Did they appreciate the gravity of the situation?
No. I think they appreciated the gravity of the situation. I think they understood. I say they. I mean, it's very dangerous to say they, talking about hundreds of thousands of people. I think a lot of them understood that if they didn't get back, if the army didn't get back, then Britain would not be defended. And Britain would be in big trouble. But I don't think they understood that they were part of a miracle, that they were part of this extraordinary. I think, and again, we'll come on to this, but it's worth saying at this point, I think what most people probably felt was that they were part of a disaster. They were part of a military disaster. They were ashamed, a lot of them, when they came back. And when they came back, they were being treated as heroes, and a lot of them were very embarrassed about that because they didn't see, you know, the evacuation as being a kind of heroic miracle. What they saw was a very badly battered army coming home with its tail between its legs. And in fact, a lot of that army, even though it was battered, hadn't fired a single shot. You know, it had, as we'll see, It had just been sort of taken by surprise and forced almost from day one into retreat without initially having any idea at all why it was retreating. So it's a really good question. That I think a lot of people would have understood the seriousness of the situation, but I don't think they would have thought of it as glorious in any way, as a miracle of deliverance, as Churchill called it.
Yeah. There's also a question here from, I'm not sure where they're asking the question from, but Miss Rawlinson asks, our class want to ask, what made you want to carry on your research into Dunkirk? So what has, you've obviously written two books on it, including this one here. So what's made you go back to it again? What made Christopher Nolan want you? Why you?
So I very good question. He asks himself that every night. The I had written, or really more edited, an oral history of Dunkirk called Forgotten Voices, where what I tried to do was take the voices of the soldiers and, you know, sailors and all sorts of people involved, and turn it into a kind of narrative to tell the story through people's own voices. So where people disagreed, where they contradicted each other, to show that. And I was reasonably pleased with that. That is what Christopher Nolan read. I think his wife gave it to him as a Christmas present. I assume she gave him something else, because it seems a little mean just to get my paperback for Christmas. But anyway, that was one present. And he read that, and that tied in with their impression of the event, because they were wanting to tell the individual personal stories, as you saw. So that's why they brought me on board as the consultant. And then I worked very closely with them and went into huge detail, tried to find everything I could possibly find in every archive I could possibly find, meet as many veterans as I could possibly find, to get as deeply inside the story as I could. And then I worked on the film, and then book the film, which was a kind of balancing act of trying to tell the history and bring the film in, but at the same time, you know, not focusing too much on the film, trying to keep it rooted in very much in the history without, you know, trying to write something too sort of glossy and too light. I wanted to keep it very much rooted in the period and bring the film with a kind of gloss over the top. So that's where I came in, really.
That's cool. Also, you can come back to these questions, Josh, later if you want. But basically, we've got two questions from Bolton. One is from FF, who says, how do you think Britain's colonies and empire would have reacted if Hitler had invaded Britain after the Battle of Dunkirk? Could they have come to our aid? That's question one. So I don't know whether you want to address that now or come back to that later. Question two is from AA. And this one says, how do you think the Dunkirk evacuation helped the Allies in their battles in other parts of the world, for example, North Africa?
Okay, right. So the first one, would the colonies and the dominions and the Commonwealth have come to Britain's aid if they were? Yeah. I think it would have been very, very difficult. So again, we'll come on to this in a bit more detail, but Hitler fully expected Britain to make peace. He didn't believe that Britain wouldn't make peace with him. He thought that in his worldview, Germany would have its empire, the East, you know, Russia, and Britain would keep its empire, you know, so India and what have you. And they would kind of split the world, although at that time, at the same time, Britain would clearly become a sort of satellite of, you know, Germany would decide basically who was in charge in Britain, and Britain would become the very good film called It Happened Here. It was made in the 60s. Really, really interesting film about what would have happened if the Germans had come to Britain. And it's very, not very well known at all, and it's brilliant. Called It Happened Here, and that's definitely worth watching. I think if either peace had been made, or the Germans had, and I will go into again, we'll go into that. Germans had invaded. I don't think there's much that the colonies and dominions would have been able to do. I think I think you know, Britain would have basically come under German control. Although, you know, the colonies and dominions, so the Australians and New Zealanders, the Indians, all these people, you know, they fought magnificently throughout the remainder of the war. I think it would have been very difficult for them to make an actual difference once the Germans had a foothold in Britain. So it's a very interesting question. The other one was, remind me.
The other one is, how do you think the Dunkirk evacuation helped the Allies in their battles in other parts of the world, for example, North Africa?
Well, it allowed the war to continue, quite simply. If the army hadn't got back, Britain would have been undefended. Britain would basically have been forced to make peace with, you know, come to terms with Germany. And then there would have been nobody left. So America might still have come into the war, but where would, for example, you know, the Second Front have come from? I mean, the American troops, well, first of all, Canadians and then American troops started pouring into Britain. And that's where, you know, D-Day 1944, they all came across from D-Day. In fact, from Operation Torch, North Africa, you know, one group sailed from America, another group sailed from Britain. Britain was, if you like, the fortress from the invasion that was launched from. That wouldn't have existed. We would be dealing with a completely different situation. If Dunkirk had not taken place, if the evacuation hadn't taken place, Britain would have been, you know, the world would have been entirely different. It's hard to exaggerate. And the fact that this wasn't just this little parochial event, the nice, fun little thing that happened It was massive. It meant the war could continue. That's what it meant. And so don't underestimate it.
Interestingly, and we'll let you crack on with a few more slides in a second, Josh, but last one before we do. I think that's 811, would like to know if you think we should remember Dunkirk as a military disaster or an amazing rescue mission. In other words, the classic triumph or disaster.
Why does it have to be one or the other?
Blame the class.
I'm not blaming the glass. I'm blaming the way we look at these things. It has to be black or white. It was a terrible disaster. It was a disaster that enabled Hitler with his hubris. You know, hubris, this idea that, you know, he was unbeatable. Hitler made this decision, which we'll come to go through the Ardennes. And from that moment on, he couldn't do any wrong. It was an amazing achievement by the Germans to basically outflank the Allies. And that was an unthinkable disaster. And then out of that disaster came this evacuation that allowed the war to carry on. And Churchill put it very well. You know, there are a lot of events in the war that Churchill covered up. The sinking of the Lancaster, that, you know, he didn't want people to know about because it would affect public morale. But on this occasion, when he gave that speech, I just played that clip from, he was being really honest with people. You know, we said in that speech, wars are not won by evacuations, and they're not. And, this was a very, very dark time. But there is a glimmer of hope because the army managed to get away. And it was an amazing achievement to do it. You know, militarily, organizationally, it was an amazing achievement. And it kept things going. So it was a terrible disaster and a beacon, I think it even said in that clip from the film, a beacon of hope was there because of this evacuation. So it's more nuanced than it just being a disaster or it just being, you know, a glory. It was both.
Because I know some historians will go with one or the other, won't they? Some historians will say it was, I mean, I've read excerpts saying it's a fantastic trial, you know, it was an amazing miracle. And then I've seen other excerpts saying it was a complete disaster. You know, so some historians will actually go for one or the other.
I mean, you know, no one can say that the defeat during the Battle of France was a triumph. I mean, you can't, however you spin it, you can't claim that for the British, for the Allies, the Battle of France was a triumph. And equally, no one can say that for the British, the Dunkirk evacuation was a disaster. But those two things are inextricably linked, the Battle of France and the evacuation. They are part of the same stream of events. And they are, you know, take your pick. What were they? They were a disaster that led to an event that gave hope.
Yeah, brilliant. I'll let you carry on, Josh. We've got a few more questions coming in, but I'll come back to them once we've
What I want to get across is what the Dunkirk evacuation was really about. Why was it happening? You had these hundreds of thousands of men retreating through Belgium and France, basically, to try to get back to England. Why were they trying to get back to England? Well, the British Expeditionary Force, the British Army, four divisions, relatively small, had been sent out to France at the start of the war. There's this idea that the British always start wars slowly, which I think is true, and isn't in some ways generally true. In some ways, is a tribute, the fact that we're not prepared. You know, we don't see ourselves as a warlike people, therefore we're always caught off guard. That seems to be historically, that often happens. The British Expeditionary Force had been sent to France at the start of the war. When the Germans attacked, as they were expected to do, the idea was that the British, you can see there, the British Expeditionary Force would go forward into Belgium. They weren't in Belgium at the beginning. Belgium was neutral and wouldn't allow British or French forces on its soil. Didn't want to annoy the Germans by allowing the Allies onto its soil. But the Germans were expected to attack through Belgium, which they did. And at that point, the plan was for the British to go forward into Belgium to the River Dyle to fight alongside the French and the belt. They did that. What was expected was a kind of World War One style war of attrition, you know, where the two sides would face off against each other. But they were blocked. Can you see that the red line towards the bottom of the screen? That is the Maginot Line. That was built by the French between the wars. They didn't trust the Germans. They expected the Germans to try again at some point. But this was a series of very strongly defended fortifications along the border with Germany that was, you know, real state-of-the-art stuff that would stop the Germans coming through. And so you had that stopping the Germans there to the south. You had the British, the French, and the Belgians to the north stopping the Germans as they came through. All as expected. The British went forward to meet the Germans as they attacked. The Germans attacked on the 10th of May, the same day that Churchill became Prime Minister. But then the Germans did something pretty amazing and unexpected. They mounted an attack. Can you see the Ardennes Forest, that light green area? It's hilly, it's wooded, it's full of trees. It's not a place where the French imagined the Germans would attack, because it's too difficult. They couldn't get tanks through there. But that's exactly what the Germans did. The 19th Panzer Corps mounted an attack through that supposedly impassable, hilly, forested area. And there was virtually no French defenses behind. So you had the German tanks just rolling through. It was really took the French totally by surprise. And just 10 days after the attack started the 10th of May, on the 20th of May, the Germans had reached the French coast, just to give you an idea. You know, they'd gone through there and they'd moved all the way through to the coast just after 10 days. Allies being the French, the Belgians, the Germans, the French, the Belgians, the British, were completely taken by surprise. It was a disaster for the Allies. The Germans, almost before anything had started, were winning an amazing victory. So you can't really claim, you know, it was anything but a disaster. And so before the majority of British troops had even seen any action, the Germans had gone past them. They'd outflanked them. They swept past them on the way to the coast. You've got Britons like this, British like this, just retreating. And they didn't know why they were retreating. So they didn't know that the Germans had pushed past them at first, were outflanking them. And they thought, you know, a lot of them thought that their own units, their battalion or their company had done something wrong and was sort of being sent back as some kind of punishment. Private Ernest, I'll read you a few accounts here, which I think are quite revealing. Private Ernest Leggett was in the 2nd Battalion of the Royal Norfolks. He said, "We were falling back, but I didn't realize the whole army was falling back. I thought we'd just be going forward again at a later date. And as we came back, I remember seeing the devastation of towns and villages. They'd just been brought to the ground. There was water, smoke, fires in the streets, and the terrible smell of death, from the houses." Lance Corporal Kenneth Carver, Royal Army Service Corps, says, "We would go through a very thick crowd of local people." This is French people. "And you'd see a clenched fist being shaken at you, saying, 'Pourquoi? Pourquoi? Why?' They wanted to know why we were running away and leaving, but we couldn't answer for the simple reason that we didn't know." So bear in mind, these British troops that you see here, they had been heroes as they arrived. The French had been so happy to see them. And they'd been, you know, a lot of them been kissed by French women and flowers garlanded. They were staying, a lot of them were billeted with French families, and they were all, and then suddenly, they were moving back. They, you know, they'd only just arrived, and they were moving back the other way. And the French and the Belgians didn't know what was happening. Then, this is cutting a very long story, very short, but after a while of the retreat, Lord Gort, who was the chief of the British Army, or the British Expeditionary Force out there, made a very brave decision. And this was pretty much a unilateral decision he made on his own, without Churchill, without the politicians in Britain agreeing to it. He decided that the army, and he's never really got his due for this, is credit for this. The army must retreat. A quick look back there, you can see where that is. Now on the coast, from where as many troops as possible could be evacuated back to England. And it's on arrival in Dunkirk that the film begins, with the British Army arriving in Dunkirk, fired at by German soldiers, and under attack by German aircraft. Now it's true, you know, if you look at the film, Dunkirk isn't as beaten up as it was in real life. Christopher Nolan doesn't particularly like using CGI, and he didn't receive permission of the town of Dunkirk to blow a lot of it up. But Dunkirk was in a pretty terrible state by the time the British were arriving in. This is the film. This is Christopher Nolan with his massive IMAX camera and his massive cinematographer. That man used to carry that IMAX camera around as though it was a little handheld camera. There he is again with that's an actor. I had a lot of chats with Christopher Nolan, and we had some very interesting discussions. Lots of things came out of our discussions. And one of the things that came out were the leaflets. Now, if you remember the leaflets featured in the film, I showed this is the real leaflet that the Germans dropped onto the British troops. You can see British soldiers look at this map. Gives your true situation. Your troops are entirely surrounded. Stop fighting. Put down your arms. Thousands and thousands and thousands of these were dropped onto the British soldiers as they were retreating. And it's quite an interesting one, this, actually, because I talked to a lot of soldiers about this. They remembered these maps, you know, these leaflets. They were dropped on them. They said they were very useful for two reasons. One, they didn't have any toilet paper, and these came in very handy as toilet paper. And two, they didn't have any maps, and they were just retreating. They said, you know, it was actually quite useful. The Germans were dropping them these maps, giving them a sense, actually, of where it was they were going to. So Nolan saw these, I showed him these, and he decided to put them in the film. So if you remember, this happened at the very start. And so the map he put in was different. Not that different, but different to the real map, because it's more filmic. It tells you, without having to have lots of sort of clunky dialogue, well, we're here, where are the Germans? They're there. This map, you just have to look at that and you get an immediate sense of what's happening. So it's cinematically very effective. It tells quite a complex story with a minimum of effort. Other things we discussed, the halt order. I don't know if you've heard about that. The probability was the British Army would have been taken prisoner, the war would have been lost, had it not for a very fortunate decision taken by German generals and confirmed by Adolf Hitler. So, as I've just shown you, the German tanks were speeding along and outflanking the British and the French. When they got basically to the outskirts of Dunkirk, the Germans stopped their panzer tanks just as they were about to enter Dunkirk, just as they were about to finish off the British Army. Now, that was incredibly good luck for the British. They were given basically an extra 3 days to retreat back into Dunkirk when otherwise they would have been completely cut off. And it has been argued that Hitler was allowing the British to get away because, Hitler had this sort of kinship with the British. He felt close to the British. He felt it is true that he felt that the British were kind of racial. You know, Hitler saw everything in racial terms. The German Untermensch and other people being beneath the Germans racially, and of course particularly the Jews and all kinds of black and Asian people, that who were at the bottom, and that is true. That is how Hitler saw the world. He did feel a kinship with the British, and couldn't understand why the British were fighting him. He thought it would be far better for the British to join him to fight the Russians. But the fact was, Hitler wanted to believe that the destruction of the British army was a job for Luftwaffe, German Air Force, not for the far less loyal German generals. Hitler was very suspicious of his own generals. And besides, the tanks had got so far ahead, they'd actually forged too far ahead of their infantry. Their infantry weren't close enough to support them. Also, you've got the fact the terrain around Dunkirk wasn't suitable for tanks. Terrain inside Dunkirk wasn't suitable for tanks. Tanks, bear in mind, the French hadn't surrendered yet. It was thought there was still going to be a lot of fighting south of the Somme against the French. So the tanks wanted to save the tank without fighting. So it's true that Hitler expected the British to make peace, and it would have been on his terms. But he wasn't just allowing the British to escape, or as it's been called, building the British a golden bridge. There were, first of all, good reasons for stopping the tanks before they got into Dunkirk. And secondly, there were also some not so good reasons. He wanted the Luftwaffe to finish, Hermann Göring's loyal Luftwaffe, to finish them off. And Hermann Göring phoned Hitler and said, "Let me do it. Don't leave it to the generals who aren't loyal to you. They'll take the credit. Let us do it." And as it turned out, Luftwaffe actually weren't capable of doing it. So there were reasons why the tanks were stopped, but it's also very, very fortunate for the British, because it's perfectly possible, if not likely, that if they had carried on, then the British wouldn't have been able to get away. Lots of things we discussed. We discussed physically distinctive units of Dunkirk. Now, may surprise you, but these are the Cameron Highlanders. They went into battle wearing kilts. They are the last British units to go to actually fight wearing kilts. And they did. They fought at Dunkirk. They actually had sort of aprons over the tartan when they went into battle. And we were talking about the fact, who should we show? Or who should, I say we, beginning myself on a bit, who should he show? So I was suggesting, why not? These are very interesting. The fact is that there were soldiers with kilts at Dunkirk. Show those. There were women present, or at least a few. There was Augusta Hersey, who's a woman, a French woman who married a British soldier while they were out in France. She didn't speak English, he didn't speak French, but something happened and they got married. And this man's commanding officer allowed her to put on British military dress, battle dress, and she went back with her husband and got across to Surrey, and they opened a shop in Surrey, and she lived there for her life. So there are all these. So I suggested, why not have her just in the background of the film, and all these ideas. He wanted to find a woman on one of the small ships. I couldn't, there really wasn't. There was a story in the Times that women had been on board the small ships, but I think that was just a rumor. We looked at the possibility of Indian soldiers and black soldiers. There were certainly Indian soldiers on the beaches of Dunkirk, but only one of the companies actually embarked from Dunkirk during the operation. On the 29th of May, but there was absolutely a unit of Indians. I looked and looked to see if I could find black troops. There were certainly black soldiers in the army, not many at this point, many, many more later on in the war, but there were a few that I could find, none actually at Dunkirk. One was taken prisoner before Dunkirk, I could find. And one never got to the beaches. We went to meet a lot of veterans. This is an interesting interview with a guy who was a beachmaster, in other words, from the Royal Navy, who was in charge of order and discipline on the beaches during the evacuation. His name is Vic Viner. Listen to this.
And the other sad thing, of course, to me is that so many of them committed suicide.
Really?
Just walked into the water.
Just how? Just walked?
Oh, just... Come on, join up. No, I'm going. Where are you going? I said, I'm going back home. He said, England's over there. I said, yes, I know, but you can't, if you walk into that water now, you'll drown. And I just did it.
So isn't that interesting? So what he's basically saying is that soldiers basically committed suicide. They basically walked into the sea. And you've got another veteran of the Royal Army Service Corps speaking of disobeying an officer during the evacuation. He says, normally I'd have been court-martialed, but the situation was so severe that didn't happen. And when I asked him whether he could tell us what he'd done, he just offered a little hint of a smile before shaking his head. In essence, Dunkirk was this anarchic bubble in which things were done, which for whatever reason, the soldiers there will never reveal. They'll never tell us what really happened. All kinds of things must have
Josh,
happened.
Can I butt in with a question here from Mia from Coombshead Academy? Wants to know, are there any stories you wanted to include in the movie, but they didn't have time to include or they couldn't include?
Oh, blimey. Gosh, so many. I'm trying to think.
Yeah. Was there any you were particularly disappointed weren't in it?
Yes. I mean, I think I would like to have seen, for example, Indian troops. I think that would have been really good to have seen Indian troops because they weren't there for very long. You know, they got away at the beginning, but I think it would have been useful to show. Yeah. Again, I don't think the Augusta Hersey, the woman, was. I really would have liked to see that, just to get the sense that, you know, this that the world was more diverse then than we sometimes think it was. We think it being a very one note, and it, actually it wasn't. Even, you know, society is more diverse now, it's true, but even back then, there was a lot more diversity than I think we acknowledge. So I would like to have seen that. I suppose in retrospect, I'd have liked to have seen Dunkirk a bit more beaten up. I'd like to have seen the beaches a bit more crowded. But then again, you know, he wasn't using CGI, and he was using lots and lots of, you know, he was using 1,000 extras, I forget the number.
Yeah.
So the beach could have looked a bit messier, but then it was, you know, I don't know. I mean, I think it did a pretty good job of giving a sense of what it was actually like. I've been talking for a while, so why don't you throw in a few more questions?
That's basically it on the questions front. There's a few others from earlier on, which I'll come back to. Let's have a look. One of the students from Cannon Slade says that Peter in the movie was a former student of theirs, Tom Connelly. Yeah, so really? That was an interesting one. What else have we got here? That's basically it. I mean, I've been asking most of them. Stephanie says they have more questions. Okay, Stephanie, well, fire them in, you can just fire them in the comments, and we will ask them away.
I suppose the next question, the big question, is how did the British Army actually get away? By ship and boat. So Admiral Ramsay, who was in charge of the evacuation at Dover Castle, started sending large naval ships and ferries from Britain over to Dunkirk to take the soldiers away. But the Luftwaffe, as we said, had the job of destroying Dunkirk, and basically they bombed the town to pieces, including the harbour. The harbour became completely useless. So there is this big harbour. It was a big port, Dunkirk. The Germans have completely destroyed it. How were the large ships going to pick up the soldiers? And it's a great story. Luckily, the naval commander in Dunkirk, so this is a naval commander who is on the shore at Dunkirk, Captain William Tennant, noticed this. This is the mole. These are pictures of the mole at the time. You can see soldiers making their way up the mole, and there's a ship docked alongside, and the soldiers are trying to get off the mole onto the ship. The mole basically is a breakwater. So Dunkirk Harbour has these two long arms. This is one of them. And it's to stop that harbour tilting up. It's not a jetty. It's never, ever, ever meant for ships to come alongside. But basically, that's what you see if you go there today. And for the film, they had to rebuild this entire huge, long, well, not the entire, but they rebuilt the breakwater. It's really an amazing story. You had all these troops wanting to get off. They started by being evacuated from beaches, but clearly not enough were getting off. So you had this man on shore, Captain William Tennant, who basically said, right, we'll try something. We'll send the soldiers up that breakwater and we'll try to get them off by mooring ships alongside that breakwater. And they tried it, it worked, and they carried on doing it. And tens of thousands of soldiers would just make their way up their mole, up that mole, onto ships on either side. They'd have to jump off. There you see again, they'd have to build, it had a big barrier all along the top. Clearly it wasn't meant as a jetty. Soldiers had to break down that barrier. They had to jump when the tide, there was a huge sort of, I forget how big it is, 9 or 10 feet tidal gap. And sometimes they'd have to jump down onto the mole. Sometimes they'd have to climb up onto the mole. But that's where 100,000 soldiers got off that mole onto ships and sailed back to England. And if you see, go there today, it's very, very moving. That's the bit that was rebuilt. For the film, they actually rebuilt it, not as long as it had been, but very much as it had been. And there are all the extras sitting on the rebuilt mole. So I hope that gives you some idea of how they managed to get the majority of people off. A lot of them got off the beach, soldiers just getting onto the beach. How did they get off the beaches? They were clearly large ships, destroyers, and couldn't get right. I hope that's not me.
That's me, don't worry.
They couldn't get right up onto the big ships, couldn't get onto the beach. So what they had to do was to send the small ships, the little ships, all these, this armada of tiny little ships to come over from England. They sent them onto the beach to get the soldiers, and those little ships brought the soldiers out to the big ships that were moored further away. So that was what those little ships were for, those famous Dunkirk little ships. They weren't there to take soldiers from the beaches back to England. They were there to take soldiers from the beaches to the big naval ships and to the big ferries that were moored further back. So you had, that's the two big ways that soldiers got away, from little ships out to big ships and back to England, or from the mole, that big long jetty that was never meant as a jetty, where, and that would have large ships moored alongside it, and from there they would go back to England. That was how people got away. Okay. And leading seaman Ernest Eldred, Royal Navy, says, I don't think destroyers have ever carried as many men as we did. It must have been hundreds crammed into every space we could think of. We just set them down anywhere we possibly could, and we gave them drinks and cigarettes. So that's there's a destroyer, and you would have over 1,000 men sometimes just crammed on board. There you see, actually, as the evacuation went on, you had more people than that. You had them absolutely crammed.
Yeah.
And then you had ships like this. This is Crested Eagle, a paddle steamer. Now, the man called J.B. Priestley was talking on the radio just after the evacuation. And this is what he was a playwright and he was very important for morale because he spoke to people. And this is what he said about the Dunkirk evacuation.
That was most characteristically English about it. So typical of us, so absurd and yet so grand and gallant, that you hardly know whether to laugh or to cry when you read about them, was the part played in the difficult and dangerous embarkation, not by the warships, magnificent though they were, but by the little pleasure steamers. We've known them and laughed at them, these fussy little steamers, all our lives. We've called them the shilling thick. We've watched them load and unload their crowds of holiday passengers, the gents full of high spirits and bottled beer, the ladies eating pork pies, the children sticky with peppermint rock. Sometimes they only went as far as the next seaside resort, but the boldest of them might manage a channel crossing to let everybody have a glimpse of Boulogne. They were usually paddle steamers, making a great deal more fuss with all they weren't proud, for they let you their works going well. They liked to call themselves queens and belles, and even if they were new, there was always something old-fashioned, a Dickens touch, a mid-Victorian air about them. They seemed to belong to the same ridiculous holiday world as pierrots and piers, sandcastles, ham and egg teas, palmists, automatic machines, and crowded, sweating promenades. But they were called out of that world, and let it be noted, they were called out in good time and good order. Yes, these Brighton belles and Brighton queens left that innocent, foolish world of theirs to sail into the inferno, to defy bombs, shells, magnetic mines, torpedoes, machine gun fire, to rescue our soldiers. Some of them, alas, will never return.
So that's J.B. Priestley with that funny sort of posh Yorkshire voice, that sort of mix that's, you know, and he spoke on the radio every night. He was very important for morale in Britain. And he's talking about ships like this, the Crested Eagle. Crested Eagle, you can see it there, that used to take holidaymakers from London up to Southend. That's what it did. And it had a collapsible funnel, would you could see that there, would sort of collapse in. It was telescopic, so it could get under London Bridge. And then suddenly it went into action. It went across the channel to Dunkirk to bring soldiers back. That was Crested Eagle at the time. And that's Crested Eagle now. It was sunk. It was sunk by Stuka dive bombers, about 350 soldiers were killed on it, and its captain, skipper, brought it inshore, and that's basically where it is today. And when that's a beach of Dunkirk, and at very low tide, there it is. It pokes out of the sand. It's incredibly moving, and there I am with a machine gun. Well, not a machine, with one of the guns off Crested Eagle, because when it was brought into action, they very quickly put guns on board. You sort of wonder how long that'll last before some sort of souvenir takes that away. But it's you still see remnants of the evacuation there at Dunkirk. And these were the little ships I was just talking to you about. This was after they'd got back. These tiny little boats that were used to take people from the beaches out to the larger ships offshore. Going to Dunkirk, and going quite a lot to Dunkirk, was interesting for me because it taught me things about the event. So, for example, I'd gone into the National Archives and I'd found a man called Commander Elwood, a communications officer, writing about the Dunkirk evacuation. And he'd said that, you know, they'd brought out a Marconi transmitter, like a radio transmitter, to give to the Navy so that the Navy could get in contact with ships, Navy on shore, get in contact with ships and get in contact with England. But it had been broken because sand got in the generator after just a few hours. And I was thinking, how on earth did they manage to let sand get? Did they drop it? How did they get sand? And when I was there, you realize that these sandstorms whip up, even in the middle of summer. You know, the wind gets up, it becomes very cold, and sand gets everywhere. And when they were making the film, they all had to wear goggles and they had to wrap their faces in masks. And you realize that's why it went out of action, because they were using it on the beach and sand just clogged it up because there was a sandstorm. So sometimes being at a place really tells you the story, things that you can't gather any other way. There's an expression, the landscape retains the story. And that is so often in history true. Here are some comparisons between the real Dunkirk and the film. And if you look closely there on the right-hand side, you'll see that some of those soldiers are actually cardboard cutouts. So Christopher Nolan wouldn't use CGI, but he would use techniques that, you know, were being used in the early 1920s in film. Again, there's the reality. And there's what he did for the film. So what you see there is the oil burning, and it created these huge clouds of smoking oil over Dunkirk, which made it difficult because when the Germans were bombing, as we've seen, you know, the Luftwaffe wanted to finish off the British. When you had these big clouds, you had partly natural clouds and partly this not natural cloud of oil smoke, it meant that the Luftwaffe simply couldn't see what was happening down below. Also, it wasn't perfect for the Luftwaffe because even though they could destroy the port, very, you know, dropping bombs into sand, the sand actually dissipated a lot of the power of the bombs. So it was quite difficult. I mean, you know, if one exploded right near you, then that obviously would have been death. But a lot of the bombs didn't do the same sort of damage they would have done if they landed on concrete or on some other material when they landed down in sand and buried themselves in the sand. And the Germans also, they had many ways of attacking the soldiers. They were bombing, they were shelling, they were dropping mines, which were destroying or attempting to destroy the ships at sea. Although the ships had been protected to some degree, there was something called degaussing, this amazing technique that had only recently been developed by amazing British scientists, whereby copper coils were passed over the hulls of these metal ships. And it meant that the magnetic mines that the Germans were dropping basically weren't set off by the ships. So if degaussing hadn't been used, then, you know, many, many, many ships would have been destroyed. As it was, I think only three were destroyed by magnetic mines. And there were also contact mines, which if the ships ran into a contact mine, then they would be destroyed. Torpedo submarines. There were all kinds of ways the Germans were trying to destroy the British. So this, again, this idea that they were allowing the British to get away, something like a third of all the British ships that were used to get the army away were either destroyed or put out of action. That's not the Germans allowing the British to get away. So here again, so there's the real, there's the fake. Many things, little things as well as big things, as you asked before, weren't featured in the film. This is one thing. You know, the soldiers, if you watch the film, the soldiers were all very young, but of course all kinds of soldiers fought. So, and here's a magazine picture from the time. You can see that that man, it says over 35 but not too old to serve. He looks quite a lot older than 35, to be honest. But people, you know, up to 50 were serving in the Pioneer Corps. Now the Pioneer Corps is basically the people doing the physical work, the people digging the trenches and making the pipelines, building the railways, doing all that. A lot of these were First World War veterans, actually. And they were a pretty rough crowd, some of them, doing the heavy work. And you don't see too many of those in the film. And then there's the fact that, you know, the film didn't have time. I suppose, actually, this may be the thing that we didn't have a chance to see. This is a good answer to that question. What did we not have a chance to see that I think we could have seen? We didn't have a chance to see the retreat. And part of that retreat was extraordinary events that resulted in people not making it back to the beaches. And so I'll read you this story. This is a man who survived and gave an interview. I've met his family since. Four sons who wouldn't be alive if he hadn't survived. Basically, on the 28th of May, 1940, so the evacuation had already started, but not everybody clearly had got back to Dunkirk yet, and some never would. Men from the 2nd Battalion of the Royal Warwickshire Regiment, the 8th Battalion of the Worcestershire Regiment, and then also the Cheshire Regiment, surrendered to the 1st SS Panzer Division. And Gunner Brian Fay was one of them. He was taken prisoner by this SS unit. Bear in mind, there's a difference between the Wehrmacht, which is the German army, and the SS, which is more of a kind of political a sort of Nazi element of the army. It's almost a paramilitary, I suppose you could say. You know, much more fanatically Nazi than the Wehrmacht, which is not to say that the Wehrmacht wasn't loyal to the Nazis. That's another argument to have another time. But instead of sending the Germans, what the SS did was force them all into this barn. I say this barn, it's been rebuilt since, but it was the identical barn on this site. And this is what Gunner Fay said in an interview with the Imperial War Museum. He said, there must have been about 100 of us in the barn, and then the Germans surrounded it and threw in hand grenades. It was apparent they were going to murder us all. I suppose the men in front took the full force of the blast, but we all went down like a pack of cards. I heard the noise of the explosion, and it hadn't damaged me, but we were terrified. And then the Germans said, Raus, five men. So five men were taken out of the barn, and there were five Germans in front of the barn with rifles. The officer counted out, ein, zwei, drei, vier, fünf, one, two, three, four, five, and these five men were shot. Now, I was already wounded, and the feeling I had was that this was so unfair, so futile, so hopeless, I decided I would be one of the next five to die. I thought to myself, I can't suffer this any longer. I'm going to get over with this as quick as I can. So the officer said, out, another five men, and I got up and I went out. A boy helped me, and we went out and we took our positions. I was number five, and they turned us all round, and I was shot in the back. It was like a punch, like a severe punch, and it knocked me over, and I suppose I must have passed out. And when I finally came to, it had all gone quiet in the barn, and I could feel this bubbling in my lung, but I realized I wasn't dead. I was about 20 yards from the barn, and blood had pumped all over my jacket, my shirt was soaked, and I could only use my left elbow and right knee. And I crawled back into the barn, and there were men in there. Most were dead, and the rest were dying. And I lay there with my head on someone's body, and we started talking. And what we were more interested in than anything else was quenching our thirst. There was no water or food anywhere. We were so thirsty. And this was the evening of Tuesday, 28th of May, and we lay there all day Wednesday and all day Thursday. And actually, I had a pack of cigarettes in my pocket, which I passed over, because there's no way I could now smoke with my lung the way it was. And at times I lost consciousness. At other times I was delirious because the time seemed to pass very quickly. And I think all of us just wanted to die. I prayed I'd be taken because I was so low. And one thing I'll never forget is that a chap who was sitting up, propped up against the side of the barn, had found a clip of rifle bullets in his pocket. And he was holding one of the bullets against his head, trying to detonate that bullet with another. He was trying to kill himself. And it's very, very harrowing. It's something I've never spoken much about over the years. But in fact, this massacre, because that's what it was, a massacre by the SS, changed my attitude to life for the better. One expression I've said many times is, they won't shoot you for it. And most of what I do, most of what all of us does, pales into insignificance besides that. Nothing else like that is going to happen to me again. It couldn't possibly. And that man became a composer in later life. He became a band leader. He worked with all kinds of people, people you may never have heard of, called, like Shirley Bassey. He wrote the signature tune to a version of Top of the Pops. I mean, he had a big, big successful life afterwards. And yet that had happened to him. It's really worth bearing in mind. This is what a whole generation of people went through. You know, we've got COVID, but we never had that. And can you imagine how living through that would have changed your attitude to life? And that whole generation is now dying out. They're almost all gone. If you do know anyone who lived through all this, it's worth talking to them and finding out how living through that period changed their attitude to life. Anyway, I might take a few questions now because I got a bit more to do. But if there's any more questions, this might be a time.
Yeah, there are, Josh. There's a few here. So we've got Elisa from Coombside Academy. What was the best story you heard that you can share? Now, obviously, you've probably shared a few already. But if you maybe had to choose one of those or another one, which would it be?
I would, at different ends of the spectrum, I think the one I've just told you, Brian Tay's, because it's incredible. That man was not meant to survive, and he did, and he had this amazing life afterwards. And it's the most life-affirming story. Which is you know, when this one I find very touching. When the ships came over, the big ferries that came and ferrying people back, they still had their waiters on them. They still had their, and there's one guy who said, he got on the ship at the mole, and they were walking over dead bodies to get on board the ship. He said he collapsed in the corner, and it was absolutely packed, but there was a waiter on board in a white coat, and they were still serving drinks because it had just been pulled out of action. And so this waiter came up to him, because he was an officer, and came up to him and said, "Can I get you anything, sir?" And this is at Dunkirk. And he said, "Well, I mean, I suppose I'd quite like a beer, if you could get me a beer." And the waiter said to him, "I'm terribly sorry, sir. The law says that I can't serve you any alcohol until we're 3 miles away from land." And this was happening whilst people were dying. And he said, at that moment, I thought, with people like this around, we can't possibly lose the war. You know, we're going to win. If this is happening at this precise moment, then we're going to win. So I think those two stories give you a sort of indication. I think also that story I told you earlier on about, you know, getting champagne behind the beaches while all this was going on. At the same time, sheer misery. There were people on the beach. The sun was shining part of the time, and somebody managed to hold him off course. And there was a circus performer doing tricks on a horse on the beach. And he said there were a whole bunch of us just standing on the beach. We'd come out of the queue for little ships, and we were watching a circus performer doing tricks on a horse. So, I mean, the whole world was there. There were all kinds of weird things going on at the same time as people were dying and people were suffering and people were getting away. So it's a complex, nuanced story. And that's what I ask you, you know, to remember. And then the other thing, I'd go back to the fact that a lot of the veterans said how astonished they were and how ashamed they felt to be treated as heroes when they got back to England, because they were. When they got back to England, people were buying them drinks in pubs, they were buying them sandwiches, they were being kissed. There was this instinctive public outpouring of what became known as Dunkirk spirit, which what it was this genuine feeling of relief. First of all, relief that family members were back home and safe. But secondly, relief that the war was still going. The war wasn't lost. That was the birth of Dunkirk spirit, which was a real thing, and wasn't just imposed by the authorities. The authorities were happy to impose it, but it was an instinctive thing that arose out of the fact that the war wasn't over. But then I asked the veterans that I met what they thought Dunkirk spirit, because you still see this in papers, you know, during the Brexit, lots of people were talking about Dunkirk spirit from all different angles. And, you know, every time something happens, people, "Oh, Dunkirk, British spirit, Dunkirk spirit." I asked the veterans what they thought it was. One man said it was the little ships that were pulled out, you know, pulling people off the beaches. Another said it was fighting on the perimeter. I haven't even gone into this, so that the troops could get into Dunkirk. Lots of British and French troops were stationed around the perimeter of Dunkirk, fighting the Germans off, sacrificing themselves, basically, so that the troops could get inside Dunkirk and get away. One man said, "That's what Dunkirk spirit means to me, those soldiers sacrificing themselves, fighting the Germans off on the perimeter." Another man said to me, "We want to survive as a country. It was about comradeship, everyone helping together." But then one man, I asked him what Dunkirk spirit was. He just shook his head. And he said, "No, there's no such thing. I never saw it." So there's never one story, you know? All our perceptions
Josh, there's one more question here for you from Alfie from Coombs Head Academy. Are there any other history events that are as significant as Dunkirk, in your opinion? Maybe the death of Jesus, but, you know, certainly are there any within the Second World War, would you say there are any that you would pick out that are more significant than Dunkirk? Maybe D-Day, but I don't know what you think.
It's so difficult, more significant, because, I mean, who am I or any of us to judge, you know, the significance, because there are so many different ways, but certainly in effect the sort of photographic negative, that, you know, on this occasion they were getting away from the beaches, D-Day they were coming back, and so D-Day is as significant. It was, you know, I'm writing about North Africa here. I think El Alamein is very significant for a lot of reasons. It was described by Churchill as the end of the beginning. It was the turning of the tide in the war, where certainly the series of losses, defeats, disasters started to turn, and it was an out and out victory for the British against the Axis, the Germans and the Italians at that point. Also, you could see it as a kind of turning point for the British, because it was a British and a Commonwealth victory that was carried out without the Americans at that point, although Operation Torch brought the Americans into the war in North Africa at just about the same time. So there are lots, and then of course, you know, Stalingrad, you look at the Eastern Front and the extraordinary fighting on the Eastern Front and the sacrifices made by the Soviets, extraordinary fighting carried out by the Russians. So there are a lot of events, I think, that are of as much significance, but significant in different ways. This one was significant because, well, part of the reason is because I don't think it's ever quite got its due, but also because, you know, without it, the war couldn't have continued. Yes, there were other things that were as significant, but in very different ways.
Josh, we're going to have to wrap it up there. But what I'm going to do is I've chosen somebody, and I'm going to choose, actually, from all the questions we've had today, I'm going to choose, let's have a look, which was a good question. We'll choose Lucy Castile. I don't know what the student's name is who asked this question, but I think it's the class, actually. 811 would like to know if you would think Dunkirk would be a military disaster or an amazing rescue mission. I'm going to send that book to you wherever you are, Lucy. You can tell me the address afterwards, and I will send Josh's book out to you so you can have a copy of that and you can give it to a student in that class. Josh, I'm hoping you're going to stick around when we come off air now, because I've got a few students who want to chat with you.
Absolutely.
Yeah, but thanks everybody from all the different schools around the UK who've joined us today. Bolton, Sheffield, Southampton, London, all the different schools, hundreds of students. So thanks very much. And we'll see you again on another chat with the historian. Thank you.